what we learned there. And the thing about it was, those back in the days when people really prayed, he would preach until about 9 o'clock. We'd have an altar service. And then he would dismiss. That was the first service. And then he'd say what they call the after service. And there would be people praying around the altars until another hour, hour and a half later sometimes. So sometimes it was close to 12 o'clock before you got out of there. But I'm going to tell you something. People got saved. People got healed. People got filled with the Spirit. And so it was an exciting thing. Nowadays, we're doing good to have a 2 or 3 day revival, which tells a lot about our churches nowadays. We're kind of letting by. But I will invite you tonight. It's at the LaGrange Gospel Lighthouse Assembly of God. It starts at 7 o'clock. And so I would invite you to come tonight and share with us and be with us tonight and get some good preaching. Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to dismiss the classes right now. And the Lord bless them and bless the teachers. Amen. Amen. Thankful for the children and the teachers. Amen. Well, this morning, I'm going to have you a treat. I'm going to sit back and relax this morning a little bit. And I'm going to have Brother Joe come up and preach for us this morning. So just pray that God's anointing would be in every single word that's spoken. Amen. Amen. But you know what? He needs to anoint your ears also to hear it, and your anoint your heart to understand. Amen. And to accept. Amen. Brother Joe.
Thank you, Pastor. I want to welcome everyone here this morning, here at Believers in Christ Fellowship, Smithville, Texas. My message this morning is titled, A Life Worth Living. I'll be taking my text from Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, Genesis 2 and 9, Deuteronomy 30 and 20. We'll start in Genesis 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Let's slip over there to Genesis chapter 2, verse 9. And out of the ground, made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and for good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now if you jump over here with me to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 20. And it reads, that thou mayest love the Lord thy God, and that thou mayest obey his voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is the life and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord swore unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for being with us here in this fellowship this morning. Lord, I ask that you open our hearts to be receptive, open our ears to hear, and open our minds to understand. Lord, we ask that you bless the words that are spoken this morning. Anoint these words, that these are your words, Lord. And touch each and every one that is within the sound of my voice. Lord, we love you. Lord, we give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. Amen. Amen. A life worth living. Stop and think about it, folks. If you're reading in Genesis chapter 2, verses 7, Lord God made man breathe life and soul into his body. In 2 and 9, God, Lord, made the trees, made all the greenery in the Garden of Eden, produced trees of good beauty, trees of life to produce fruit and the tree of good and evil. So you see, God did not just do one or two things. He made it all. He made man not just to be his companion. He made man also to be dominion over all that he made. You know, and if you look at all that, then you look a little bit further down in Deuteronomy, you know, that thou mayest love Lord, the Lord thy God. We need to understand that God did this for us because he loved us. And we need to remember that we need to love God in the same way that he loved us, without any questions. We must obey the voice of God. When he comes to us, speaks to us, we need to listen. There's too many times that we're not really listening to what he has to say. And he's here for our entire life, the life that he gave us. He wants us to dwell in the land that he produced, that he made. He wants us to be happy. So I ask you this morning, when you wake up, how do you feel? I'm not talking about not just physically, but emotionally. How do you feel when you wake up in the morning? You open your eyes. Do you look around? Do you thank God for watching over you the night before? Do you thank God for the day that he's given us? Sure, we're going to have our physical aches and our pains. We all are getting older in our lives. We're all going to have those aches in the morning. But you know what? Once you get up and get moving around, what happens? They go away. So you really need to remember that when you wake up in the morning, you have to have an understanding that it's going to get better. So I ask you this. What is the reason for getting out of bed? You ever think of that? Do you just wake up and jump up and go get your cup of coffee ready for in the morning? What is your reason for getting out of bed? What kind of attitude do you start your day? You know, we have to have the understanding and see the fact that no matter what we do throughout the day, God is there. He made it for us. He made everything here and gave it to us. Like it says in Deuteronomy, he gave it to the fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. He gave it to all them and us. You know, we ask these questions. How do we feel when we wake up in the morning? What do we look forward to? Do you ever stop and think about those things? Stop and think when you wake up in the morning. Before you even climb out of bed, thank God, number one, he washed over you during the night. Thank God that he's going to be with you throughout the day. Thank God that he is in control. So I ask you, what makes life worth living? Jesus is life. And if you look over in John chapter 10, verse 10, and I want you to think about this after you read this. This is Jesus talking. The thief cometh not, but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. Jesus is telling us here, right here, he came to give us life. He came to give it abundantly. In John chapter 11, verse 25, you know, we're talking about all these things that Jesus has done or will do. And at the same time, if you read John chapter 11, verse 25, now this is Jesus talking to Martha, the sister of Lazarus, right before Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. And it says, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. He's telling Lazarus' sister, even though he's dead, I will raise him from the dead. And he does. He gave Lazarus life. He gave him a second chance. Jesus is a giver of life, as it shows here in John chapter 11. He gives abundant life, as in John chapter 10, verse 10. And he gives eternal life. We have to look forward to the eternal life at the end of the rainbow. Little story to give you a little food for thought. Two boys and their father go to the local carnival. The father purchases armbands as they enter the gate. As the boys are, the father walking through the midway, they hear shrieks of joy and fun of all those who were riding on the various rides. Their faces were lit up, much like the bright lights. And you could see the grins from ear to ear of all the excitement the boys could see. As they watched, they could just imagine the feeling of lightness in their stomachs as they're riding the ride, rocking back and forth and having a good time. And her father told him, says, I'm going to leave you boys. Y'all have a good time. Y'all going about your way. I'll come back, catch up with you. So they're walking through, looking at all the different lights and all the different rides, and they're thinking, wow, that looks like fun. And they see all the different people, the crowd of people, all having fun, enjoying themselves. But yet the boys, they had no money. Their dad paid for the armbands and paid for them to get into the carnival. But they had no money of their own. So they were basically left just to kind of watch the people have fun, stand back and enjoy, watch them having fun and enjoying themselves. But they had no money to buy tickets for the rides. So they're standing around feeling miserable, watching everybody, and they're wishing, well, I wish Dad would come and pick us up so we can go home, get out of this. So they hear a voice in the background. Hey, boys, what are you doing? Nothing. What do you mean, nothing? Why aren't you riding the rides, having a good time? We don't have any money to buy tickets. The father looks at him and says, well, boys, I bought you armbands. These armbands paid for everything. That's included in the cost. All these rides, everything is free. All you have to do is get on them and ride them. I paid for it already. So these boys are amazed at what all they had been missing out on. They've been missing out on having a good time, missing out on having fun riding all the rides and enjoying what everybody else was enjoying and having fun. So they missed out on it. But you know what? Not only were they stunned about the fact that they could have been out there having a good time, but it was almost time to go home then. You know, sadly as it seems, we have Christians out here that are wearing their bright colored armbands. They're walking around looking at everybody else, watching everybody else have fun, watching everybody else enjoy what God has given them. Enjoy peace and being fulfilled with contentment and freedom. They're all miserable because they're not being involved. They watch others that have the full assurance and victory and blessings. Looks inviting, but they don't see any way how to pay for it. They stand around wishing that their father would come and get them out of this place. And yet maybe if they listen closely, they might hear his voice. What are you doing? Nothing. Just watching everybody else. Why aren't you enjoying yourself? Why aren't you enjoying everything that I have given you and have provided for? We can't afford the tickets. God looks down at him and says, my child, don't you know that all is included in the price that I already paid? Jesus did more than you can save. He gave you life, a blessing. He did more than just reserve you a place in heaven. He gave you a wonderful, anointed life here on earth. Don't you know that it's included in the price he paid? Think about it. Walk around with all these brightly colored armbands thinking, what is going on? We have everything. It's already been paid for. Jesus paid for it with his life when he went to the cross. We had communion this morning, thanking Jesus for what he did. But you know, many of these Christians that are walking around with these brightly colored armbands are missing out on the spirit of what Jesus and God had given us. Missing out on all the blessings Jesus offers. It's like they're at the carnival, but they're not riding any rides. Jesus died to give you life, abundant life. He promises you peace, joy, contentment, assurance, victory, and confidence. So why simply wear the armband? Get on the rides. Make life worth living. What does Jesus bring you? He brings you great joy. He brings you peace, contentment, satisfaction, blessings. And by the way, we can't outgive God. We can try all we want. But like I said, your money's no good. You can't buy what God has already given you. You can't buy what Jesus paid for on the cross. If you look in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 16, this is where confirmation that Paul's ministry to the Philippi was effective. You know, their godly behavior and witnessing for God, this will be proven on Judgment Day. Philippians chapter 2, verse 16, and it reads, "Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain." Paul taught the Philippians many things, and they finally understood the fact that the Word of God is exactly what it is. They understood finally that what they were doing for God was not going to be overlooked. When they stand in front of God and God looks down at them, and he's going to say, "Welcome, my faithful son or daughter," whatever the case may be, because they understood what the word meant. Paul was a very good minister, and he got his word across to the Philippians. And this tells us that God gives understanding. He gives goals for what we need to do. He gives us directions. So here we're talking about, in the beginning, God gave life to Adam. He made all the trees in abundance. You see where Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. We see all these things that God had given us, all these joys, all these promises. All we have to do is ask for it. There's nothing to pay for. There's nothing to buy. You ask for it, and the word says, "Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened." Right here in the Bible. So we don't have to pay for anything that's already paid for. Would you go to Walmart and buy something and get out the door and then say, "Oh, I'm going to go back and pay for it again"? You wouldn't do it. It's paid for. Why pay for it again? It's already taken care of. The bill is done. It's over with. So, you can have a life worth living. You know, it's totally up to everybody, not just here in this sanctuary, but everyone out there listening. It's your choice. You can either get on the rides and have a good time, or you can stand back and watch everybody else have a good time. It's your choice. It's your decision as to whether you make God part of your life. And it's your decision whether you make God, allow him into your life and be saved. Like I said, God did not go to the cross. Jesus did not go to the cross just to give us salvation. Salvation is just part of what's behind the cross. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. Would you read, turn with me there. 1 John chapter 5, 11 through 13. "And this is the record that God hath given us eternal life. and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you, that beloved of the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. This is all goes right back to God gives us eternal life. All we have to do is accept him into our heart. Accept him as our Savior. You know, like I was mentioning earlier, we go through life taking advantage of things that God has given us. But worst of all, we take it for granted. We take so many things that are out there available for us to just not notice it. Like I said, when you get up in the morning, thank God for getting up and being with you through the night. As you're going throughout your daily life, thank God for being there, watching over you. I hear so many different things where people talk about, you know, if I had left for work 5 minutes later, I would have been tied up in that accident down the road. If I had not listened to God and gone out to the garage, that gasoline pouring out of the bottom of my car would have caught fire. Folks, we have to listen to God. We have to understand the fact that he has given us everything we could ever ask for, and then some. Like I mentioned earlier, you cannot outgive God. In fact, if you look in Revelation chapter 20, in verse 15, and it says, "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." I want to close at that point there, and then what I'd like to do is I'd like for everyone to search your heart. Think about what your life is all about. Think about, why are you here? You're not here just to take up space, folks. We're here to enjoy what God has given us. We're here to reach out to other people. I'd like to take a moment here, and I'd like for everyone just to close your eyes, and I want you to just stop. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. I'm not going to ask for anybody to come up front or anything. I'd like for you to bow. I want everyone to bow their head, close your eyes, and just search your heart. Search and see if there's something, anything at all, that's preventing you from enjoying what God has given you, enjoying what your life is all about. If you have something, I'd like to just kind of slip your hand up nice and quiet. I want to pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. I'm not going to point anybody out. I want you to feel that you can reach out to God.